testify to any limitation. I'm saying hello to the God of all creation. There are no limits with you. There are no limits with you. You're limitless, nothing's too hard for you. You're limitless, there's nothing you cannot do. You are bigger and you're greater.
Morning, everybody. I'm Kyle. Wanted to welcome here to Catalyst this morning. We're glad that you have hashtag blessed us with your presence this morning. Jamie's falling down on his job for me. What we got here is we've got a connection card. This is what we would really love for you to fill out and give us this morning. We'd be hashtag blessed if you gave it back to us. If you haven't figured out, this morning we're talking about hashtag blessed. So Matt's going to have a great message. Richard, have your kids taught you what a hashtag is yet? Awesome. So Richard is finally with us. So if you could greet somebody around you, and we'll get back to playing music in a second.
Come on, y'all.
the way you make me brave. You make me brave. No fear can hinder now the road of midway. You make me brave. You make me brave. You call me out beyond the shores into the waves. won't relent until you have it all.
Like this to you. We can sing words about not being forgotten by you, God, not being looked past by you, God, knowing that you're for us, that you're not against us. Father, I just pray that these things we have sung would not just be words, they would just be our anthem of our heart to you. And God, they'd be a reminder from you to us that we are underneath the love of a God, that his love crashes over us wave after wave. And Father, I know in my heart there are people in this room right now that feel distant, that feel overwhelmed, that feel burdened, that want to give up. And so Jesus, I just ask that you would just roll, that you would touch people today, that your love would remind us that there is a God in heaven who is our creator, who knows us, who made us, who knows the good and the bad, and yet you love us still the same. You know the depths of our hearts and you love us. And while we were still sinners, Christ died for us in our place. The holy for the unholy, the beautiful for the wretched. And you look at us and you say to us, if you'll just know me, if you'll just walk with me, then you will have a life bigger and better than anything you could imagine. So Lord, I just ask, Lord, that you would open up our minds and let us see what is truth, what really life is about. Clear our mind and our eyes of the distraction that we think is what life is. And God, you speak today. God, you let us know what life really should be about. Well, we invite you, Father. We invite you to come speak to us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you guys for being here. You can be seated. I want to read something to you. This song we just sang is one of my favorite songs ever, and I want to tell you why. And if you ever read the Bible before, there's a book. It's called Wisdom Literature. It's called the Song of Solomon. And people don't really know what to do with the Song of Solomon. Anybody ever read Song of Solomon? It's a little heated. It's a book it's a erotic story of love. And people are like, I don't know what to do with it. It's about a man and his wife, and it's pretty explicit. If you know the language of the day back then, you transfer it to today, they refer to things that aren't really Sunday morning kind of material, things you never see on a felt board, I promise, in children's Sunday school. And some people have argued that it's only a book about a man and his wife and his lover. And some people have said it's got double meaning, and I really think it does. It's also a picture of the way that God loves his children, us. This intimate, passionate love that God has for us. And this verse, that we just sang the song, You Won't Relent, comes from Song of Solomon. And it's in chapter 8, and it says this. It's referring to, this is the woman who is longing for her groom, her husband. And here's what it says, and this is just the lyrics. She says to him, set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm. For love is strong as death. Jealousy is as fierce as the grave. Its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love, neither can floods drown it. If a man offered for love all the wealth of his house, he would be utterly despised. In other words, this kind of love is something that cannot be purchased or bought. And so this morning, we're looking at this idea that there's a God in heaven who desperately has done everything in his power to know us. We're looking at it through this series called Hashtag, and I'll set it up for you again. How many of you have ever used a hashtag before? Some of us have. Some of you are like, I don't know what a hashtag is. Hashtag, I'll just do hashtag. You can go around and talk hashtags today. If you say something embarrassing at lunch, you go hashtag awkward. Or if you're at lunch by yourself, you can tweet out hashtag lonely. You know, whatever you want to do. But a hashtag is a summation of a bigger thought. And this morning we're looking at the idea of hashtag blessed. We're looking at the idea that people in our culture, they use this idea of blessing, and you've seen it before. You've seen it on like award shows. Somebody will get up and they'll use profanity. They go, but bless God or thank God. And you're like, you got two things going on. And people say, hey, I got my new job. I'm blessed. Well, I would argue you're probably blessed before you had the new job, too, you know, or what happens to the person who doesn't get the new job? Are they not blessed? Or, you know, when you pray for your team to win, like I've been desperately praying lately, I need some people to fast with me for Auburn. Anybody, any faithful fans out there? War Eagle. We don't really get in that here, but I got to tell you, we need some prayers, folks. I got to tell you, I mean, We'll take them. I'll put that on my prayer card and turn it into y'all this week. We need some prayers this week. But the reality is we have a definition of blessed that's different. The Bible has its own definition. What God says is very, very different than what the world says. And think about what the world says is blessed. You know, what do people in our culture strive for? They strive for things, for finances, for if I can just have, and you have an amount in your mind in the bank, I'll be hashtag blessed. Or if it's a guy, if I can have I had a conversation with a young man this last week. He said, if I could just find me a good looking girl, I'd be happy then. And I was like, dude, you may not ever find a good looking girl. So, don't pat people in the arm. And we all have our own definition. Inside of you, I would say there's an equation that says hashtag blessed equals, and you have filled out in your heart, you have filled out the other side of the equation. You have. Every one of us has. For men, most of us, if we're married, it's if I can protect, take care, provide for my family, right? That's inside of all of us. It's deep down inside of us. Ladies, you're wired for protection, for to know that things are secure. But all of us have got a definition of something that means blessed for us. So here's the question for this morning. Just think about it. The question is, what makes you happy? Because I would say the ultimate goal for all of us is to be happy. Would you just admit that? If not, why do you pay $5,000 to go to Disney World? We all, deep down, long-term, want to be happy. Can we just all agree with that? Can I get an uh-huh from you? You don't do things that make you unhappy long-term. You might say, well, I don't like my job. Your job may make you unhappy, but you're doing it so you can do things that make you happy. You ever been there before? You sit in a cubicle, which is on your own little prison cell, and you're there, and inmate to your left, inmate to your right, and you have your little jokes, and you serve your time, right? We've all been there. I don't like it here. I hate it here, but I serve my time here so that I can, and fill in the blank of something that makes you happy. See, we're all striving for this. We're all wanting ultimately to be happy, and we fill it in our lives with things like education. If I can get this extra degree, or if I can get this job, or if I can get this spouse, or if I can have the right number of children, or if I can live in the right neighborhood, or if I can drive the right car, or if I can this, that, and the other, if I can get the promotion, if I can have the superiority at work. We all have our own definition of what it means to be blessed, and you do too. Now, if I asked you that and I made you answer the question, almost all of you, if you have been in church for a while and you've been in Sunday school, anybody been in Sunday school before? You know, you ever heard of Sunday school answers? It's that answer you give without even thinking. Jesus? Like, we asked about the flood. Still Jesus. Jesus was in the flood. He was over the flood. And you come up with, so I want to tell you something. I'm going to ask a provocative question this morning. And this is a crazy question. If there was no God, what would you turn to make you happy? Think about that for a second. I'll give you 30 seconds. If there was no God, what would you turn to make you happy? Just rattle that around your brain. I was praying for us last night, and the Lord asked me this. And I gave some answers. My family, my son and my sons, providing. And then the Lord said to me, and he wanted me to tell y'all, if we don't keep that in check, that's the thing we'll struggle against. That'll become our God. You ever felt that? Because we lose sight that there is a God and that he is who he said he was, that he rewards those who seek him. And if we're not careful, we will turn to that thing that does bring us some short-term happiness, and we will turn to it to make us happy. A few years ago, Jamie and I visited a small little home called the Biltmore. I mentioned to you before. I want you to see it. Now, this is a picture of the Biltmore. It's not even the whole thing because you got to be so far back. Anybody ever been there before? It's ridiculous. It's amazing. At the peak of the time there were dozens and dozens of servants. There were three people who lived in this house. For a while, it was the largest house in America. I think the largest residence in America right now is for sale in Birmingham. Anybody seen the video about it? It's a 60,000 square foot home by a guy. His last name is House. That's pretty ironic. He was one of Scrooge's partners, which that, whatever that means, you know. And he has this house. And there's a video online. We're going to show it this morning, but it's too long. There's this video online about this house, and they're talking about all the millions of dollars they put into this house trying to make it feel like a home. It doesn't even touch what the Biltmore has done. This was built. Here's a picture of one of the studies inside the house. And it's more overwhelming in person. I mean, you go in and you're just... Here's a picture of the main hall for Christmas. It's like Downton Abbey, isn't it? I'm ashamed that I know that. But it's like Downton Abbey. 18-year-old Matt would travel through time and kick my tail for knowing that now. But this family, they built this home, and you can go online and read about it. It took dozens of years, thousands of workers, all this money. They bought all this land. They literally rerouted a little mini small river through the grounds so they'd have a certain appeal to the house layout. And the family lived there like less than 3 years. And you can go back and look at some memoirs, some things they said. They said it just didn't feel what it was supposed to be like. Now, I would say when you've been in that home, it's amazing. I would say to you that that's kind of an icon of all the things that we chase in life that aren't satisfying. That we think, if I can have this house, if I can have this spouse, if I can have this job, if I can have this bank account, if I can have this car, if I can have this whatever, if I can have this thing. And the problem is houses lose their appeal and spouses get older just like we get older. And sometimes things happen and you're not with a spouse. And children sometimes get sick and things happen. And all that stuff that we just hold on to so, so tightly loses its appeal. The chrome grows tarnished. If you're a man, you have known someone who went through their midlife crisis, and what did they do? Some really stupid stuff. They lost track of the life they were given, and they said, I've got to change this life. I've got to do some stuff. And I would argue with you today and try to encourage you through Scripture. We're going to look at a verse in a minute, that the reality is God has created us to know Him. It's been said this way. St. Augustine said it. He says, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they can find rest in you. Now, without hearing your whole story, how many of you with an uh-huh would agree with this statement? Oh, yeah. See, you made us for yourself. God Himself made us, wired us, designed us for Himself. And it says, our hearts are restless. The reason we always said you bring your friends here, invite your guests, because I know lots of people whose hearts are restless. Who do you know whose heart is restless? Maybe your heart is restless. Maybe you're going, I'm not satisfied. I'm not content. I don't have joy anymore in the whatever. All of us have had a moment where we have done things that used to bring us a lot of joy, and there's no more joy in that thing. You ever been there before? It's miserable. It's miserable. St. Augustine knew it. Later on, there's a guy named Blaise Pascal who lived in the 1600s as a math genius. And he said it this way. This is a summary of his quote. I'm going to read you the summary, which we've all heard. Then I'm going to read you the real quote, and it's way, way better. It's a little more complicated, but it's way better. The summary says, there's a God-shaped vacuum. Some people say hole. Some people say void. But there's a God-shaped spot in the heart of every person which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God the Creator. Have you all heard that before, or some version of that? There have been songs written about it. The original quote says this. What else does this craving and this helplessness proclaim but that there was once in man a true happiness of which all that now remains is the empty print and trace? In other words, at some point, we knew what happiness was. When God makes us, our Creator makes us to know Him, that's that void. But then it says, this he, the man, tries in vain to fill with everything around him, seeking in things that are not there the help he cannot find in those that are, though none can help, since this infinite abyss can be filled only with an infinite and immutable object, in other words, by God Himself. I would say today that God Himself defines what a blessed life looks like. Would you agree with that? You and I have our own idea of what we think a blessed life looks like, and we chase that idea until God stops us in our tracks and reveals to us what a blessed life really looks like. What it looks like. Go to your next high school reunion and look at all the people who are chasing what they think a blessed life looks like and ask them, are you happy? It's a powerful question, are you happy? Are you content? How's not being sarcastic, but how's that working out for you? I've had friends who have made lots of money doing all kinds of things, and I've told them about us planning a church and how most Saturdays there involves a time me driving a yellow Ryder truck that has some mold on the side of it through the interstates, and the gauges don't work real well. So I'm like, I don't think we're, you know, you're not speeding, because I mean 55 downhill is it, you know. But you're, and I'm going, and I'm driving, and I've told my friends about it. I had a friend that lives in D.C., has this phenomenal job high up in a government agency, and he said, man, your life sounds awesome. And the world looks at our lives and would say, you're planning a church, and you're, it's hard work, and it's, there's not a lot of, everything's new and untested, and I've had friends look at me and that envy what we do here. Man, I'd love that. I'd love to be a part of something that matters. I would tell you that the God, the author, has a better definition of what life looks like blessed. We say things like hashtag blessed if you get a car or a house or a job, and Jesus stands in contrast to that. We're going to look at a verse out of the most famous sermon ever preached, out of the Sermon on the Mount. You may have heard it before. Or it's through the book Matthew. It's Matthew 5, 6, and 7. It's three chapters where Jesus just basically sits down and he talks and he shares about life. It has been studied, scrutinized, looked at for thousands of years. It has been called the best literature ever. It has been called the best poem, the best homily, the best delivery of a simple way to follow God that's been ever given by anybody ever before Christ and ever after Christ. It is simple words, and it talks about how we should live. The introduction of it is called the Beatitudes, and it's basically the attitudes you and I should have. We're going to look at that today. I want to give you a little background. In the Old Testament, the very last verse of the Old Testament says, and he'll restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the land with a curse. It's in Malachi chapter 4. Some people, I had a friend that called that Malachi, the Italian prophet. It's not Malachi, it's Malachi. It's a curse. It's a curse. So the Old Testament ends with a curse. Basically, if you don't turn to me, this is what's going to happen to you. But the New Testament begins with blessings. The Old Testament ends with this curse. New Testament begins with blessings. The Old Testament was characterized by Mount Sinai. Remember Mount Sinai where they got the Ten Commandments? The New Testament is characterized by Mount Zion, this new delivery of grace and salvation from God. The Old Testament, the law in the Old Testament, which was you had to sacrifice animals to be right with God, demonstrates our need for salvation, and the New Testament answers that salvation through Christ. The Old Testament is the book of Adam. Remember the story of Adam in the garden? Was it a good story? Tragic story, bad story. Bad decisions were made, repercussions that affect us today. He was given dominion over the earth, subdue and rule it, but that monarch fell. The New Testament begins with a new king that has dominion over the earth, and his kingdom brings blessing to us. This story you're going to read today is Jesus, the maker, looking at his people and saying this, I want you to understand how you should live. Men, it's like us getting a new appliance, and what do we throw out the instructions, right? I don't need no stinking instructions, and you throw that away, and 30 minutes later, you're Googling, how do I install the ice maker on my new stainless steel fridge, because we don't know. Well, this is Jesus looking at us saying this, you've been missing it. When Jesus came in Jerusalem, the whole New Testament world, Rome had taken over, and you've studied Rome in school. Rome was the dominant force. Think in our grandparents' lifetime, very much what Hitler was trying to do, take over the known world. Take over the world, rule the world. And Rome had a method, and they were really good at it. They'd build roads, they had a phenomenal army, they had supplies, an army would go in, conquer a place, and instead of keeping the people separate, they encouraged their people marry within these people you just conquered. So Roman men would marry non-Roman women, and they'd have babies, and their allegiances were split automatically even from birth. And Rome was taking over the world. Rome had taken over Israel. And Jesus comes, and the people looking for a Messiah, they've been enslaved for thousands or hundreds of years at this point. They've been paying taxes they didn't want to pay, and they're looking for a Messiah that would come and save the day. Lead the army, change things, uproot, and give us a new kingdom. And Jesus comes, and he speaks differently than anything they thought. He said words that were very different. And these are the words that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5. He says this: seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. Whenever you see Jesus talking about crowds, other verses say he looked upon the crowds and felt compassion for them, for they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Christ cares about people. We were talking with the students earlier, and we did a little survey of how many people do they know at their schools, or how many people are at their schools. And then Kyle and I were in there. We're not in school. There were 8 people in the room out of the populations of our schools, and the number of people Kyle and I know on Facebook, we have 10,000 people we know. Now, that doesn't mean those students know every person at their school, but they're connected with those people. Christ cares about crowds, and we should too. So he sees the crowds, he went to the mountain, and he sat down. Here's something interesting about him sitting down. In our culture, if you sit down, it's more informal, right? Kyle, do you ever sit down in front of a judge when you're doing law stuff? No, that's improper. You wear a tie, you stand in front of the judge, you don't twiddle your thumbs, you don't lounge. In biblical times, if Jesus was walking and kind of sharing his heart and asking questions, that's informal. That's informal. But when the teacher sat down, it was like, now the lesson begins. Isn't that good? Isn't that like a little thing you see in scripture? Like, well, so he was sitting down. They called him rabbi. They called him teacher. Jesus knew the Bible intimately. He wrote it. In his humanity, he had most likely memorized the first 5 chapters of the Bible, even as a little boy. Now, we know he had a kind of a double identity. He could have dipped into his nature as God because he wrote the Bible, but I also believe there are times he was just a little boy. He threw rocks and tried to make a slingshot, and he did. He knew the word. So he sat down, and he opened his mouth, and he said this, verse 3. He said, blessed, this is our word for the day, are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This idea of blessed is a life of favor that's given by God. It's not a house. When we're reading through these, look for the things that it doesn't make mention of being blessed. If you went home today and you turned on certain channels on the TV, you would find pastors open up God's word, and they would try to tell you, if you follow God, you'll receive a X, whatever that thing is. I heard a pastor one time, I wish I had a DVR, but he was saying, if you don't have the car you want in your driveway, this is what this guy said. He said, go out in your driveway and take a bucket and take a rag and take some soap, and you imagine yourself, you have faith enough, and wash that imaginary car, and God will bring it to you. And I wanted to throw my Bible through the screen, because that's not at all what a blessed life looks like. Mike and I were having a good conversation about this week. I do believe this. I think sometimes God gives you the ability to make money, and you need to make money and be generous with it. Rich Mullins was a songwriter. He wrote Our God's an Awesome God, all these great songs. And he wanted to go be a Franciscan monk. His dream was to go live in a monastery and like sing to Jesus all day and write songs and be a monk. And he had an uncle who was a farmer, and he goes, well, that's an idiot thing to do. Rich Mullins says, why? His uncle said, you've made a lot, you have a gift. Why don't you make a lot of money and just give it all away? And Rich Mullins thought, well, that's a better idea. So Rich Mullins, this prolific songwriter, had his account. He said, I want to make whatever a working man makes, minimum wage, 50 weeks a year. I want that to be my pay. And I don't want to even see the rest of it. I want you to give the rest of it away. And Rich Mullins, when he died, lived in a little trailer on an Indian reservation, teaching these basically third world country kind of kids. Not Indian like over in Asia, India, but like in America, Indian reservation. Teaching them music and about the gospel, because their population had so much drug and alcohol abuse. And this man who would have been a millionaire lived in a little trailer and taught these little kids about Jesus through songs. Our definition of blessed is different than God's definition. When it says blessed are the poor in spirit, some have tried to make that to be like financially poor. It doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that God, if you're poor, you don't love God. What it means, and we're going to look at each of these verses, when it says you're poor in spirit, it means you and I come to the conclusion that we don't have enough spiritual finances to save us. Can I get an uh-huh from somebody? It means if you're a believer in this room, and some of you are considering it or contemplating it, it means you've come to the place in your life where you have looked at your spiritual condition and you have said this, I am poor. I'm broken. I'm sinful, I'm rebellious. And Jesus says, when you get to that place, heaven's yours. When you realize you cannot do it on your own, when you realize spiritually you're bankrupt, when you realize I haven't got enough in the bank spiritually to save me, then Jesus says this, you're in a great place to be forgiven and receive heaven. Verse 4, he keeps going, says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Does it mean that Christ wants us to walk around all the time crying? Does anybody think that's what the life Jesus died for? No. But it does mean when we see things that are contrary to God's word and we see brokenness and we see injustice. You know what broke my heart? The Pope stood up in front of Congress last week. He didn't say Jesus' name once. That broke my heart. The spiritual leader of the largest Christian denomination on the planet didn't even utter the name of Jesus. They wouldn't have thrown him out of Congress if he did. He's the Pope. He could have gotten up there with his translator and said this, I want to tell you, no matter who you are, no matter where you've come from, Jesus Christ loves you. And he died for you. And we have all this imbalance and all this struggle, but I want you to know something. If America, just like Europe and just like the rest of the world, if we'll turn to Jesus, he will bring healing to our land. He could have said those simple words, and he didn't, and it just broke my heart. When I see videos about murdering babies for profit, we should mourn over those things. I can't even watch them. When I meet people and I see them chasing things that don't make them happy, I mourn over that because it breaks my heart, because I know that Christ alone brings comfort. And Jesus says to us, when you mourn over the things that make his heart break, then you're going to find comfort. Folks, everything's not great, but there's a Christian godly way to respond. And Christ says, blessed are you when you mourn, you shall be comforted. And in verse 5, he says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The word meek is not, we think of meek like meaning a weakling. Meek is like power under control. Meek means you don't always have to say what's on your mind. Jamie and I have had this discussion over and over again. We both have the personality. When I would have hated me in middle school. Some of y'all probably knew me in middle school. You probably hated me then. I would have hated me because I always knew the answer. Hand was up before the question was finished. Y'all know. And you know, the truth is most of the time I didn't know the answer. Meek means sometimes you put your hand in your pocket. You ever been there? Parents, is it hard to know the answer for your kids, that sometimes you got to let them learn the lesson? When Christ says, blessed are the meek, what he's saying is there's a real blessing when you can look at God and be humble in front of him. You don't have to always speak up. We don't have to always be right. Husbands and wives, when you have intense family fellowships, aka fights, you don't always have to win. If you win, what do you really win? Anybody been there? You don't win. I showed her. Well, yeah, okay. There'll be a great distance in your bed tonight. That's the no man land. That put barbed wire and landmines in there. Nobody goes there. That's right. Did you win? You didn't win. And Jesus says, if you're meek, you'll inherit the earth. Humility, being humble, thinking less of yourself or thinking of yourself less often is a great, wonderful thing. And Christ encourages us. Verse 6 says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. You know what this means for us? You and I can't be righteous. The word righteous means right living. It means living a way that is perfection to God. In the New Testament, you see verses that Jesus says, unless you're more perfect than these, you'll never see heaven. And 1 Peter says, be perfect just as he who called you is perfect. Well, does anybody in this room think you can be perfect? Anybody? Anybody have a spouse that are like, man, he's almost there? Anybody? Mom, is dad almost there? No. If Miranda was here, I'd ask her. Blair, you're not there. Larry, is Christy almost there? She's nodding her head, yes. She's like, I'm more humble than I should be. I'm pretty awesome. No, the reality for us is none of us can be righteous on our own. So when you hunger and thirst, you know what it means? It means you hunger and thirst for Jesus, because he's the only one who can make you righteous. The Bible says that God demands perfection. In the Old Testament, the old law was that they had to make a sacrifice. The sacrifice had to be of a perfect animal. Couldn't be with blemish. Couldn't have anything wrong with it. Couldn't have one less leg or a bad eye or bad fur. And it was a picture of the New Testament requirement for Christ to live a perfect, sinless life to die for us. Because here's the reality. You and I all earned a cross. On Jesus' cross, it had some names that were mocking him. But the reality is it should have had my name, my address, sacrifice my social security number on that cross because I have earned a cross, just like you have. In my sin, I have offended God. I have looked at God and said this, I know your laws, I know your ways, but I'm going to do it my way. And Jesus dying on the cross said this, Matt Andrus, you don't have to die in your place. I'm dying in the place for you. There's a point when I was in middle school and God started drawing my heart and changing my heart and revealing me to him. And I started going, I can't be right on my own. I can't save myself. And this verse came true in my life and I was satisfied in Jesus alone. See, for you, unless you have turned to Christ, there will be a day God will draw your heart and start working on your heart. And you're sitting here today, he's doing it today. And you're going to go, I don't understand it. And there'll be a moment, hopefully, prayerfully, that he'll reveal to you, you can't save yourself. And if you'll own up to that moment, it'll be the best moment of your life. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You know why we show mercy to people? Because we're sinners too, right? The next time somebody offends you or hurts you, know this. The depth of our offense to God is infinitely stronger and bigger than anything you and I can ever do to each other. And the reason that we forgive before people forgive us or even ask us to forgive them, and sometimes we forgive people knowing they're going to hurt us again, is because we know this. Because while Christ died for us while we were still sinners, as believers, we're trying to follow his example and we're trying to show mercy because we have seen and received much mercy. How many people do you know that have been to churches before who felt driven out because they didn't receive any mercy? Anybody? Had a conversation last month of a person who was saying this, I've got some questions and I don't feel like I can go anywhere and not be judged for asking my questions. And this is who we're supposed to be. It doesn't mean we tolerate sin or we wink at sin, but it does mean that we go, I'm a sinner too, and you're a sinner, and we're all jacked up together. But thank God for Jesus. So let's just sing about Jesus, and maybe his song will be louder than our song, and maybe the gospel will be louder than my sin. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to be merciful. We're going to show mercy to people who need it, and we're going to watch God just keep on bringing folks. I believe if we as a church could just do what God's called us to do, he's going to keep bringing folks. Do y'all believe that? I pray every week for God to send hundreds of people. But I also know that God wants us to make sure we're where we need to be, health and some things structured and things. But I know this, if we can create an environment where people can walk in these doors and they're genuinely welcomed, no matter what their color is, no matter what their orientation is, no matter what their lifestyle is or what they've been through, if we can just welcome people and be Christ to them, Jesus is the most attractive thing in the world. His beauty overwhelms everything else. And if we can just do our best to show them what he says to do, they will be drawn to him. Or they'll never come back. And it doesn't really matter. Either way, God's sovereign. But our job is to do this, is to be merciful. Verse 8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Again, where do we find purity? Anybody? None of us have pure hearts. The scripture says God judges the motives, not the deeds. I love the Friends episode where Phoebe and Joey are trying to do a good deed. You ever remember that episode? Yes, I'm a sinner. I watch Friends. Okay, it's a horrible show. I know it. They all hooked up with everybody. I know it. You don't have to send me an email. But there's some things in that show, and they were trying to, and they couldn't come up with a good deed. They couldn't come up with a deed that was not selfish. The whole episode, 22 minutes plus commercials. They were trying to find something they could do and they couldn't find anything because everything we do is driven by some kind of motive inside of us. You have pure in heart because you meet Christ. Verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Verse 10, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The reality is probably none of us in this room have ever seen corporate persecution. In Iran right now, there's a pastor that's in jail for doing what I'm doing right now. He's been in jail for 3 years preaching the gospel in Iran. This verse says he's blessed. None of us have probably ever been really persecuted. Now, if this was made illegal, what would happen to you? If we had to meet in someone's basement or we had to meet in a barn behind somebody's house out in the woods, what would we do? This says, blessed you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. We don't face persecution. There are parts of the world in China right now, they There's a guy named Watchman Nee who planted churches in China, and the Chinese government shut down the churches. And it was closed doors for 50 years. And 50 years later, the doors were open again, and the Chinese church had grown exponentially faster than any church in the world. And they asked some of these leaders, what can we pray for you? We're going to pray that the government will stop persecuting you. And they said, no, don't pray that, because that's what makes us grow. And they interviewed him. Why would you say that? They said, because the government shuts us down and they'll kill our leaders. And a young man or young woman will step up and say, I'll lead now. It'll be worthy to die for Jesus. They'll step up and they'll lead. And they'll get taken off and killed. And two more or three more will step up and say, man, they died for something worthwhile. I want to make my life count. And they said they'll kill one and four or five more will pop up. In the world that happens in America, we've got all the freedoms we want and the church is not even keeping up with population growth. And Jesus said, blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. He knew that when you suffer and you handle it and you keep your chin up and you point to God and you say, this life is maybe horrible sometimes and loneliness is here and people die in sickness and poverty and horrible things, but my Jesus is better and eternity is better and heaven's going to be better. Christ knew that when we could look that way and talk that way and be that way, that we would bless the world by our example. Verse 11 says, blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. And then he finished up this little introduction and said, rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. This is the maker looking at the made, looking at the created and saying, you know what? It's not just to live here. It's to think about what's going to be long term. And Christ says, rejoice when you face these things and be glad because your reward is going to be great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So here's the recap. Jesus says you're blessed when you are, one, poor in spirit, realizing you can't do it on your own. Spiritually, you're bankrupt. When you are mourning, when your heart is broken over the things that break God's heart. When you are meek, which is another word of being humble or full of humility. When you hunger and thirst for righteousness. When you're merciful. When you show mercy to people, even though they don't deserve it. Does somebody in your life this week need to be shown mercy? Is there somebody you work with you would like to throttle? Yes. Yes, be honest. And you can be Jesus to them by showing them mercy. Jesus says you're blessed when you are pure in heart, when you're peacemakers, and when you're persecuted for righteousness. So here's how we can approach this. You and I can do one of two things with this. You can treat this as a to-do list. Anybody ever done this before? I need, and in your mind right now, you're going, well, man, I got to be more poor in spirit. I got to work on that. I know how this works. I got to find something to cry about. Dang, I hate crying. I'm not really a crier. Does that mean I got to hug people? Ugh. Some of you are going like, meek. There's nothing meek about me. I got to find a meek person and watch them. I know what you're doing. You're creating your to-do list. Man, when I get home, the kids are going to screw up. I'm going to give them grace on one thing. I'm not going to beat their tails. They're going to deserve it. But the second time is going to be a double whooping. I mean, I'm going to get mine. But I'm going to show them grace. And you're going, I got to be pure in heart. I got to stop saying or watching or doing whatever. And then you're thinking, well, there is that guy at work that makes fun of me for being a Christian. I won't avoid him as much. Maybe he'll make fun of me some more. Therefore, I'm blessed. Hashtag blessed. And the reality is, if you do that, you missed all of it. These aren't the rungs in the ladder to being blessed. These are evidences of a life that follows Jesus. If you look at Christ, and I wish we had an hour to do this, he was the perfect example of all these things. Now, he wasn't poor in spirit. He was still completely right with God, but he looked at people and he taught them, you know what, apart from me, you can do nothing. He taught this truth. There are times it says he went and prayed all night long. It says he cried over groups of people. He had compassion. He was moved to tears. All of these things that he said to have, he exampled. So here's what our hope is today. Our hope today is that you and I would look at Jesus and say this, I can't be any of these things. Can y'all disagree with me on this? You can't be any of these things on your own. And the day you realize that, you're going to find some freedom. But our freedom comes when we say, I can't do any of these things, but Jesus can, and Jesus does, and Jesus will do these things through my life. So what I need to do is I need to transfer my hope from me into Jesus. There are three things you need to do with this today. We want to apply this. The first thing you need to do, what does this mean to you, is it means that we must all be a new creation. On your own, your old nature, you can't do any of these things. You know it. Your wife knows it. Your husband knows it. Your kids know it. You are not humble naturally. You're not poor in spirit naturally. We are prideful creatures. We think we can do it on our own. So we must be new. The second thing is, if you have a good grasp of reality, this should push us to Jesus. For you today, you may say, man, I'm already a Christian. I'll tell you this. Then seek after Jesus. Because these things, these attitudes, these blessed attitudes that God will give you can only come through a pursuit of Christ. You know, what does that mean for me? It looks a little different for everybody. All of us learn differently, right? How many of you are audible learners? You hear something and you learn it. I am not. I'm visual. I like to hear like a good sermon, but I'm visual. Blair and I were talking the other day about we're buying houses. We're trying to put a fence in. He's like, we need to put it up to so-and-so. I'm like, don't talk to me about it. I don't understand that. Draw me a picture on a napkin. Well, I'm like, you don't understand. I don't listen to you. I've already checked out. I hate to say I don't care. I do care if you sketch it for me. Draw it out. Give me some lines. What do these lines mean? Draw them. All of us learn differently. For you, for me, I was tired this morning, and every Sunday mornings are a hustle. We're trying to get everything ready. I drove the truck over here, and I'm in here kind of getting everything done, and Larry's over here singing, and he sings that line, you are for us, not against us. Woo! The Holy Spirit said, do you get it? In that moment, that brief little moment, because I love music, I love singing to the Lord. In that little moment, God spoke to me and said, it's going to be all right. For you, I don't know what the thing is that God speaks to you, but you've got to find it. You got to find it. Because there are no tutors in this thing. You are one-on-one with you and God. And we do our best to kind of whet your appetite and tell you how good he is. But if you go home and say, man, I like how Matt knows that Bible. Who gives a rip how much I know the Bible? How do you know the Bible? I've heard people say, well, man, you talk to God and it feels like he talks to you. He does. But there are hours and hours of talking. I don't hear him say anything back. But the hours of talking are worth the 5 minutes of response sometimes. And the sitting and being still and going, God, you got to show up because this whole situation is just jacked up. And then God just kind of ushers his way in the door and moves. And you're going, praise God, I invited him into this. You have got to find out what it means for you to know him personally. You can't eat the scraps off of Beth Moore's table. Or for me, Charles Spurgeon's table. You got to find a spot at the table. And Christ invites you to know him. These attitudes, these blessed attitudes should remind all of us this is only found in Jesus. Not half Jesus and half me. Not any of that God is my co-pilot crap. Only in Jesus alone can you find this. And the third thing is it shows us an example of what true happiness and success looks like to God. I want to read a verse to you. We're going to be done. In the Old Testament, this has been God's message, folks. This is not a new message. This is a message that's been repeated over and over again. I did a whole semester studying a guy named Jeremiah. And Jeremiah was they called him the weeping prophet. He sat outside the temple in Jerusalem and he cried about the state of things. I hope in heaven he's over that. I hope he's like, hey, I'm Jeremiah. You know, I'm hoping he's happy. I'm sure he will be. In Jeremiah, at the beginning of this book that he wrote, he says this, and this is the message for today. God speaking through the prophet, and God says through Jeremiah, for my people have committed two evils. Number one, they have forsaken me. Forsaken means forgetting. It means choosing another over. When you say your wedding vows and you say forsaking all others, it means at all the men in this room, when you say that vow, you're saying this, I choose this woman over all the other women. It's the opportunity cost of I can only have one wife. Choose wisely. And God says, you've forsaken me. And then he calls himself the fountain of living waters. Does that sound reminiscent of something today? All my fountains are in you. This is where this comes from. And then he says the second thing. And they have dug out cisterns. You know, what's a cistern? Not sister, cistern. It's a well. They've forgotten me. And here's the second thing the people did. And they have dug wells for themselves, broken wells that hold no water. So the whole message of the Bible is this. We have done two things against God. We have forgotten him. We've forsaken him. We've chosen others over him. And we have broken things that we trust in that don't hold any water. When the Vanderbilt family moved out of that house because they said it just didn't feel right, the Biltmore estate is a broken well that can't hold any water in all of its grandeur and all of its beauty. And all the stuff that we chase because we think it'll make us hashtag blessed, that leads us empty and wanting and desiring, is a well that holds no water. And God himself, and Jesus called himself, the fountain of all living water. A fountain is replenishing over and over again. When you feel dry and you feel defeated and you feel worn out, you go to the fountain of living water. Today, my hope for you is that you won't think that we're bashing any of the things that we have in life. Nobody's against houses or cars. But we are against, and think God's against, us looking at those things and saying, I'm going to be happy because of the house and the car. A blessed life is a life that's surrendered and following Jesus alone. That's it. Nothing else. And those other things are just icing on the cake that sometimes you have and sometimes you don't. I like cake without icing sometimes. And I asked you earlier, what makes you happy? We answered, some of us gave the Sunday school answer, then we qualified it. If God wasn't real, what would make you happy? Think about that thing. Does it sometimes get in the place of God in your life? I'm going to pray for us. And what I want us to do is, I want you to think about this week. I want you to think about, is Christ the very center of my life? Because this blessed life, Jesus himself, our maker, said it comes through him. We can't do that on our own. It's not a to-do list. It's not a be-better list. But Christ is the perfect fulfillment of all those things. And that's what our focus needs to be. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the scripture. Thank you for Matthew 5 that looks at us and says, you may think you know what blessed means, but these words of Jesus, they echo through life and they even echo into us today. And they remind us that it's not the stuff we have. It's not even our health. It's not how we look or what kind of cars we have or what clothes we wear. It's about if we have found and if we know you. And even finding you, you find us. So Father, I pray for us. I pray for every person in this room that they would look at themselves, they'd look at their hearts and ask, am I really happy? Not that short-term stuff, but am I long-term? Am I happy? Am I satisfied? God, I think it's a blessing that you don't allow us to always be satisfied with things that don't fulfill us. And you let us get to the end of our rope and we don't find fulfillment in all that stuff. So God, I ask that you would move on hearts. If there's somebody in this room today that doesn't know you, God, that has never received your forgiveness, I pray they'd have enough courage to write down a question on that connection card or mark a spot they want to talk to someone. And God, give us the time and the logistics to catch up this week and talk. Father, we love you. Lord, I thank you that you're moving. I pray you'd keep drawing people to Catalyst. Keep bringing families to help us lead, help us grow. And God, we want to reach more people for you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Blair. I'm the brother that he doesn't listen to.